Okay, so one of my favorite webcam manufacturers, ObSpot, just quietly released what I think is probably the least expensive pan-tilt zoom webcam ever at around $99 that does automatic tracking versus remote control tracking. And I would say it's kind of ahead of its time being able to shoot 1080p at 100 frames per second. So is it any good? Well, let's find out. Again, this is the ObSpot Tiny SE, and you might have guessed that the SE, well, it kind of sounds like how Apple uses the SE designation, and that's kind of the case here, where it's the lower price variant of the ObSpot Tiny 2 Lite webcam, and it's just $99 MSRP. So why don't we move on to the webcam so you can see how it looks. I'm going to start with the default image settings and without installing the ObSpot Center app. Okay, so this is the ObSpot Tiny SE in all of its default settings. So you can see what the camera looks like by default. Everything is kind of 50'd out in terms of its default settings in Windows. I don't even have the ObSpot Center software installed yet on this computer, just so I can test it out, just what it looks like plug and play. And you're also hearing the built-in microphone on the ObSpot Tiny SE. Okay, so those were the defaults, again, without using their app, so without installing anything, just using what's in Windows. Now I'm going to show you the tuned image settings, again, just using Windows built-in camera settings. All right, so this is the ObSpot Tiny SE. Now these are the tuned settings from Windows. I haven't installed ObSpot Center yet. I'm not doing anything in OBS here in this case. And what I did was, basically, I took the brightness down to about 35. I took the contrast up to about 75, left the sharpness at 50, and also toned down the saturation a bit. In addition to that, I turned off my fill light because I think my face was just overly lit. There were no kind of shadows or anything. So this is the ObSpot with tuned settings, less light than before, but I think it looks a bit better than it did before in terms of not being, you know, so flat. And these are the built-in microphones on the ObSpot Tiny SE. All right, and because I get this question a lot, how does it work in low light? And it's got a 1/2.8-inch sensor, which isn't the biggest, but it does claim to have good low light performance. Let's take a look at these same base settings that I just set in Windows in low light. This is the ObSpot Tiny SE in very low light. I actually have no light firing at my face. I only have a bit of overhead light behind me, and my bookshelf is lit up, but there is nothing that's kind of firing at myself directly. And I gotta say, it's pretty good in terms of showing detail, and I kind of, in a weird way, I don't really want to say prefer it, because it's not quite as detailed as what it was with all the light around it. But, you know, if you're a gamer or something, I think this is pretty decent low light performance. Again, the ObSpot Tiny SE. Okay, so those are just the Windows settings. Now let's move over to what the ObSpot Center app can give you with some additional image settings. Okay, so this is the ObSpot Tiny SE. This time I've tuned the settings in ObSpot Center. The main difference that I've made here, because it's got some HDR tuning involved in terms of how the camera's built, is that I have turned on HDR. Normally I wouldn't turn on HDR, especially on a webcam, especially on a 1080p webcam, because it will tend to do things like with the lights behind me, or actually kind of lessen the dynamic range weirdly versus like having it not turned on. In this case, I think it actually brought in some more shadows and more dynamic range like it's supposed to do, given its name is High Dynamic Range or HDR. I took the compensation for the exposure down just about 0.3. So it's just a little bit off of zero, a little bit lower. So that kind of toned down the lighting a little bit too in terms of its harshness. And I set a few things on the camera itself. So contrast, I bumped it up to 60. So the 60 kind of made the blacks a bit more black and kind of made things look a little bit more how I see them. I turned the saturation down just 3 to 47. It was default at 50. And I set the sharpness at 55, which is kind of a double-edged sword, because usually that will cause things like, say, the background to get grainy and maybe the sharpness of my face to get better. In this case, I think it's a good balance in terms of just going up a little bit, like 5. And the background still, to me, looks pretty crispy, maybe a little bit of graininess, but not too bad. and I left the hue as it was at 50. Now, normally OpSpot probably has the best out-of-box tuned settings in terms of image, so you'll notice that pretty much all of the settings, with the exception of contrast, are within plus minus kind of 10% of their defaults. So I think the image looks pretty good, and this is the microphone again. And I'm in standard radio distance mode. Was it close by default? I've moved it to standard just to see what that sounds like. It looks like it's not clipping or anything. So this is the default microphone on the OpSpot Tiny SE with the tuned image from OpSpot Center. Okay, so I've got to say, this is probably the most useful implementation of HDR, at least that I've experienced in a webcam. 99% of the time, I actually turn off HDR if that option is available to me. Because ironically, even though it's supposed to mean high dynamic range, the feature tends to give me lower dynamic range and kind of flattens out the image and the shadows quite a bit, at least based on what I can see in my monitors. Maybe if I have an HDR monitor that's better, those will come through, but at least in my testing, HDR tends to be a big disappointment in almost every webcam. In OpSpot land, they're kind of calling this feature staggered HDR, where the camera captures simultaneously different exposure levels and puts them together. To my understanding, that's how HDR works anyway, generally, and that there are a couple different layers of HDR. And that's why a lot of, say, 4K capable sensors are put into cameras that can only max out at 1080p, because they're using that extra compute and capacity to create a second layer for HDR. Now, my assumption here as well is that this camera probably would have been capable of 4K, but OpSpot have kind of optimized the firmware and the software to produce the best results at 1080p, which is probably most usable for most streaming or online meeting applications, while keeping the most software and kind of tracking capabilities in place from their more expensive PTZ cameras. And compared to the other OpSpot Tiny PTZ cameras, the biggest difference here really is the maximum resolution, which is 1080p, which is something they haven't really offered since the original Tiny PTZ, where they had a 4K and a 1080p version. Whereas kind of their newer PTZ cameras, are the Tiny 2 and the Tiny 2 Lite, are both capable of 4K at 30 frames per second. Here's the thing though, it is ahead of its time a bit, because this one can do 1080p again at 100 frames per second, whereas most quality webcams and cameras in general can usually just do 1080p 60 or 4K 30. That said though, 100 frames per second isn't the most useful feature right now, outside of maybe using it in slow motion type treatments. In my tests, trying to upload 100 FPS videos to YouTube, for example, the process literally drops every other frame and cuts that video down to 50 frames per second. So it's not really even playing back anywhere that I can find at 100 frames per second. So even though it's a 1080p webcam, it's still a future-proof investment. And if you have to have 4K, things like upscaling now and also Super Res are getting better and better and more common every single day. And that also leads me to my next point. So this is a PTZ camera with auto tracking for under $100. So even if you don't think that you need that capability right now, it's just $30 more than the static version, the OpSpot Meet SE, that I recently tested, and you can check that out with the link on the screen. With this one though, you do have that nice two-axis gimbal that will track you and even supports things like hand tracking or lower body tracking, those types of things. And you can even use zone tracking that kind of parks the camera in one position, and then it only moves if you leave that zone that you've defined, and then it actually parks it back in the zone once you've returned to it. Let me show you how that works.
All right, so this is the OpSpot Tiny SE. I've got zone tracking enabled, which is my favorite type of tracking, because what I can do is basically move around within the frame and not have it follow me. But once I go a little bit out of frame, it will actually capture that and it will follow me out of frame. And then if I move back into the zone, it's going to basically lock on the zone where I wanted to lock it onto.
And there's also hand gesture control to enable or disable tracking, as well as zoom in and out with digital zoom. The other thing that's pretty cool is that it works with the Elgato Stream Deck if you're streaming or using it for remote meetings like I do. And even though it's not mentioned anywhere in the Amazon listing, but you can see bundles with it, it actually does work with the OpSpot remote control that you can see here, so that you can do things like control the pan tilt zoom and the gimbal and everything from the remote control, and also presets on the remote as well. And something that I had a lot of fun with were the beauty effects. So let me show you a sample of what I mean there. What I'm gonna actually do is turn off the retouch man mode with a few settings that I set. And here's what I normally look like. There I am with no filtering, no retouch. And I'm gonna go ahead and turn the man mode back on. And I'm back in man mode just so you can see what software can do for you if you wanna change the way you look a little bit in real time with a webcam. I think the key here really is that less is more sometimes. And if you go too far, you'll start to look a bit like Anouk from TikTok Singing Fame. Cheers. So let me know in the comments what you think. Now, if you're in the market for a good all-around webcam, even if you don't right now want auto tracking and PTZ functionality, it's a great choice. You can always disable auto tracking if you don't need it right now, or set up presets to aim, for example, at your normal desk position, top down on your desk if you want to see a keyboard or things that you're working on your desk, or just manually move it in the software or with the remote control. Now, for me, it's kind of a no-brainer to get something like this at its price point. It's probably the best budget webcam on the market right now. You agree?